All right. Greetings, greetings, everyone. Thank you so much for joining today. I am delighted to join you for a webinar today. This is the next in our series of From the Field webinars from the International Crane Foundation. And we have a great one for you today, I hope, on cranes, Kafue Lechwe, communities and conservation on the great Kafue Flats of Zambia. Before we start up our presentation for you today, just going to do a little bit of housekeeping here. First off, we are recording this webinar and there'll be a link posted afterwards. So please feel free to share that link with all your friends and neighbors. We love to get the word out on all this work. So we appreciate that very much. And also, if you have any questions throughout the talk, please queue them up using our Q&A function. And Karen Morrison, who is our Africa Program Director, is with us today as well. She's going to go through all the questions as we go along and send me some good ones that I'm going to ask to my co-presenters, Mwape and Griffin, at the end. And we will have an opportunity to address as many of your questions as possible so you can send them throughout. And I finally, before we jump in here, I just want to have a special shout out to our sponsors today. We are so grateful to all of our From the Field sponsors. Jean and Ed Eloranta, and they have actually sponsored in honor of their Kasoma family who live in Zambia. They're in Lusaka right now. Zachary, Emily, Tessa, and Caleb, they're in Lusaka, Zambia. And hopefully they'll be able to watch this live or as a recording. So that's just wonderful. And if any of you would like to sponsor a future From the Field webinar, you can contact Kate Fitzwilliams at the phone number or email given below here. And we invite you to do so. There's a lot of great From the Field webinars coming up, and we really appreciate your support. All right, let me jump right in here then and give you the feature presentation of the day, Cranes, Kafue Lechwe, Communities and Conservation of the Kafue Flats. I am really delighted today to be co-presenting with two wonderful people. Mwape Sichilongo, showed on the left here on the screen, and Griffin Shinungu in the center. I was going to put field photos of all three of us up here. I always like to show myself in the field so I don't look like a bureaucrat sitting behind my desk. But with Mwape, there's no separating Mwape from his hat there, so I had to keep that one, so I didn't get Mwape in the field. But you see Griffin in the field there in the middle. Collectively, they are our Zambia Crane and Wetland Conservation Program team, along with others running one of our major programs worldwide for the conservation of floodplain wetlands in Zambia. You're going to hear a lot more from Mwape and Griffin in a moment, and they will further introduce themselves as well. But I've had the pleasure of working with these two guys for about a decade. I've actually been with the International Crane Foundation for nearly 30 years now. And I've actually been in Africa 27 years in a row. I just did a tally since 1992. I have lived or worked in Africa every year, and COVID is putting at risk that tally for the first time in my professional life. So I hope somehow I find a way back over. I miss it there, but I love working over there, and Kafue Flats is just one of my favorite places in the world. I'm so happy to talk about it today. We are going to talk about three things during our talk today. Under the theme of a thriving floodplain for all, and we'll explain very much what that means. But first, I'm going to give you a quick intro why we should care about the Kafue Flats, and then my colleagues will join in for the meat of the presentation. We'll talk about challenges and opportunities for the conservation of the flats, and how are we making a difference, giving you some concrete examples of what we've been doing and what our vision is for the future. So let's start. Why should we care about the flats? I've had the great privilege with the International Crane Foundation to travel to many places, and you've had the opportunity to see some of these places in recent webinars, like Poyang Lake in China, the great coastal wetlands of Texas. There's so many beautiful places out there where cranes dance. In Africa, amazing places we go to. I had a great opportunity to visit Chad about a year or two ago, see these amazing scenes with black-crowned cranes. But the part of Africa that most cranks me up is the big floodplain region of Southern Africa. There are five big floodplains that we work in that are just magnificent systems. This is the Okavango Delta in Botswana, the Zambezi Delta that empties to the Indian coast of Mozambique. You've got the beautiful in Zambia, the Lua Plain, with the biggest wildebeest migration outside of the Serengeti in far western Zambia. You've got the big Bungwelu wetlands in the north of Zambia with their weird and wonderful shoebill storks and lots of wattled cranes. And then you have this wonderful place called the Kafue Flats that we're going to talk about today. Just one of my favorite places on earth, a big, beautiful wetland. What makes the Kafue Flats so special? It's a river-fed floodplain system. This map gives you a little sense of where Zambia is in southern Africa and where the Kafue Flats is within Zambia. It's a huge floodplain system fed by the Kafue River, flows down from the north of Zambia and spreads across this big floodplain. Of note is that, as you can see, two national parks there in the middle of the Kafue Flats, the Lochinvar and Blue Lagoon National Parks. Those really protect the core area, and all surrounding those parks is what's called a game management area, which is also a big protected area. So a lot of the Kafue River and Kafue Flats system is protected by these parks and a big game management area. This is the Kafue River weaving through the flats. It's a very meandering river, spilling water into this beautiful floodplain, creating all kinds of interesting water bodies, open water lakes and papyrus swamps, big, beautiful water openings and wetlands as far as the eye can see across this immense floodplain, and beautiful vegetation communities that grow up within those water bodies and out on the plains. The surrounding uplands are really lovely too. African savanna. This is one of those big, amazing baobab trees you can see just on the periphery of the Kafue Flats, right where the floodplain comes in. And also there's all kinds of interesting land features in geology, including hot thermal springs in the upper parts where you can touch and feel very, very hot water coming in on the border of the flats as well. So amazing geology and beautiful vegetation communities. But what the Kafue Flats is so famous for is two species in particular. One, this beautiful, very aquatic wetland antelope called the Kafue Lechwe. The only place it's found in the world is on the Kafue Flats, and they occur in big herds across the flats. As Mope will talk about later, historically more than 100,000 of these animals gracing the flats, feeding in this big area, and it is the iconic mammal of the flats. And the iconic bird of the flats is our friend, the wattled crane. In fact, this is the most important place on earth for the wattled crane. It's a vulnerable species worldwide. There's something less than 10,000, maybe 9,600 wattled cranes left, which makes it one of the rarest cranes of the world and one of the rarest birds in Africa. They are decreasing, but they are doing well in some of their strongholds, including the Kafue Flats. And the Kafue Flats has more than 3,000 of these wattled cranes. So it's really an amazing global stronghold for the species, about a third of all wattled cranes in the world out on that floodplain. Why is it so important for wattled cranes? There's several reasons. One is it's a huge floodplain and wattled cranes like a lot of territory, but it also has a ton of this sedge that's shown in this picture here called Eleochris. It's a spike rush, and wattled cranes really love to feed on the tubers of this plant. There's a picture of one of our friends holding up a tuber there, and they feed out on these big floodplains on those tubers. And they cover vast areas of the flats, so that's very important for their feeding. And also there's very good nesting habitat for them. They can nest when the waters are high, and this nest here actually shows a couple of tiny little eggs in the middle there. They nest out there to avoid getting harassed by people and trampled by wildlife, and they nest at the high flood. And then when their chicks hatch, they can feed their young on all the insects and just the burst of life that comes with the flood recession. The uplands of the Kafue Flats are also really important. When floodwaters are too high, the cranes can move out to the periphery and stay out in these outlying areas of the flats, like in this photo shown here, and an opportunity for them to use the season throughout the floodplain throughout the year, depending on the season. We've seen the biggest flocks of wattled cranes anybody's ever seen in the world out there. This is one flock that was about 450 wattled cranes just in this one flock swarming across the floodplain. Just fantastic area for these birds. Lots of other important wildlife there too. Big hippo populations are out in the more permanent water bodies of the Kafue Flats. It's a big grazing system. Used to have huge numbers of zebras, of wildebeest, of buffalo and other animals out there along with those lechwe. And more than anything, it is just a critically important place for bird life. One of our other crane friends and cousins of the wattled crane, the gray crown crane, also live and breed out on the flats. It's one of their important areas too. There's also bustards, the slaty egret, very important area. And also in particular note, has big populations of vultures. And along with the cranes, vultures are one of the more endangered families of birds in the world. And there's big populations of several species on the flats that are supported by this system. All told, more than 470 bird species on the Kafue Flats, just incredible numbers of a great diversity of birds. It's a wetland of international importance under the Ramsar Convention, very important international recognition, and also an important bird area under BirdLife International, just acknowledging those diverse and abundant bird populations that you see out on the flats. But the bird and mammal story is only part of the story of this amazing floodplain. And what's so important about the Kafue Flats and these other big floodplains of Southern Africa is all the services and values they provide to society for food and clean water, for fish, for photosynthesis. They support recreational values. They store carbon to help protect against climate change. They help control and store floodwaters that can be used later in the hot, dry season. They provide so many natural services, nature services, to the people of Zambia. And that's just as essential as their wildlife values. And people in particular on the flats use this floodplain to graze their livestock, to support fisheries, for their water supply, and for other natural resources. And people have been using this system over the millennia for their livelihood. So it's a kind of a wetland system that has been invaluable for wildlife and invaluable for people for as long as this system has existed. And that system has changed a bit these days, and we're going to talk about that, but it's longstanding, very important values. And then finally, this is a part of the world that is extremely poor, this part of rural Zambia. There's very few opportunities for cash income for people living out there. So these parks and this system are also a really important opportunity for income from people through park management, tourism, when that can get up and running again, because that's getting hit right now very hard during the crisis, and local businesses related to park management and tourism. So these are just all the diverse ways in which this park supports people and wildlife. And then finally, before I turn it over to Mr. Mwape here, we're especially excited about this system as a regional center for climate change resiliency. It's a real oasis during the increasing drought and water scarcity that Southern Africa is facing. And there's just tremendous opportunities, again, for wildlife and people for this system to really help Zambian society. So I want to introduce my good friend and colleague, Mr. Mwape Sichilongo, to take over from here. He is our Southern Africa Program's regional manager, heading up these big floodplain areas in Zambia. So Mwape, please take it away.
Thank you very much, Rich. Mwape Sichilongo, Southern African Floodplains Regional Manager. Greetings from Zambia. I've been involved in conservation for a long time. In fact, I started out as an intern. My interests are in community conservation, environmental policy and practice, protected areas governance, and anything species, protected areas, and people. My first time on the Kafue Flats, I was 14 years old, and the image of the flocks and herds that I saw have remained with me since then. So I'm privileged to really talk about the challenges and opportunities that the Kafue Flats is facing as we set out on this important journey for us. The major challenges that the Kafue Flats is facing are no different from the ones that are troubling protected areas management world over. And the main one for the Kafue Flats is the loss and decline of wildlife species, mainly as a result of poaching. Lechwe has been in decline over the years with a regular annual net loss of about 2,000 animals. And this is largely due to limited capacity on the ground to effectively protect the lechwe. What has also happened as a result of this decline is that the lechwe population, according to the Department of National Parks and Wildlife, has declined by 80% from the 70s up to the present time. As you can see from the graph, the decline is steady. And we have been warned that if, and you can see that from the graph, that if we don't take any corrective actions in the next 10 years, we could face a local extinction of this important endemic and iconic species for the area. The Kafue Lechwe population has also been affected in the sense that its historical distribution has been decreased. They're currently concentrated in an area between Blue Lagoon National Park on the north bank of the Kafue River and Lokinwa National Park on the south bank. The brown dots in the middle represent where the lechwe have been documented to be in the 2018 official survey by the Department of National Parks and Wildlife with partners. And the areas marked X are where they historically were found. This decline in lechwe and other mammals is of concern to us because of an observed relationship between large herds of mammals and cranes. As you can see from the map, the areas marked brown are where the lechwe are, and the areas marked red are where the cranes are. And you can see that where the cranes are, so are the lechwe. So the status of the lechwe is related directly to the status of cranes. And if anything continues to happen as the decline of lechwe has shown, we fear that this globally important population of cranes might also be affected. What we have also observed is that the fisheries is another challenge in the area. And fisheries is affecting the Kafue Flats in two ways. The Kafue Flats is an important fishery supplying up to 20% of the national fish demand, according to a study by the World Wide Fund for Nature. And this is affecting the Kafue Flats in two ways, in the sense that the illegal or uncontrolled settlements associated with fisheries are occupying high ground, which lechwe need for their dispersal, particularly during flooding. And this is where the settlements are also taking place. The second way in which the fisheries associated problem affects the flats is that the settlements which are supposed to be temporary are becoming permanent, as you can see in the picture. The iron sheet roofing represents more permanent structures in the area. Another threat that we have seen is the increase in livestock. You can see from the numbers indicated there that they are outnumbering lechwe by a factor of 6. As Rich mentioned, this landscape has had communities keeping livestock for thousands of years. So the concern is not the presence of livestock, but the fact that the numbers have been increasing and have increased dramatically over the last few years. And if you see on the map, areas that were previously occupied by lechwe, as shown by the brown dots, are now occupied by livestock, with the lechwe concentrated in that important area I referred to earlier on, represented by the purple dots that where the lechwe are. We also are seeing increasingly that there is close interaction between large herds of lechwe and large groups of livestock. And this interaction could increase the threat to lechwe through increased human presence that could lead to poaching, but also competition for space that could negatively affect lechwe, and especially in terms of the habitat available to the lechwe. Another problem that we have seen, which is the fourth challenge in the area, is invasive species. And my colleague Griffin, who has worked in the area for a long time, is going to talk about that in more detail. But the invasive species, particularly Mimosa pigra, affects access to habitat for species, including waders, some of which are seasonal migrants. But also because it forms a thick, impenetrable mat over the area, it's inaccessible for both wildlife and fisher people that want to access the area. The fifth problem that affects the Kafue Flats is related to water development. Below the Kafue Flats is a dam, and above the Kafue Flats is another dam, and this has led to unnatural flooding of the area, with some areas that should be dry being wet at the time when, at the wrong time. And this tends to affect our wildlife behavior, both in terms of dispersal and movements. The final problem we have observed on the flats is that of mining. Of course, Zambian legislation allows mining in protected areas, but this is under strict conditions as set out in the environmental impact assessment guidelines. So the challenge is that if the mining is not controlled, it has potential to affect the tourism potential of the area and being unsightly, and also the potential for pollution. So having identified the six core challenges that the Kafue Flats is facing, the question we are asking ourselves is how we can make a difference in such an ecologically and economically important area that nonetheless is a conflicted floodplain. And we have, as the International Crane Foundation and Endangered Wildlife Trust, want to use our interest and our knowledge of the area and commitment to apply to finding the solution. And the basic solution is a long-term agreement that we have entered into with the government of the Republic of Zambia through the Department of National Parks and Wildlife. And in this, we are with the Endangered Wildlife Trust and the Worldwide Fund for Nature. In the picture is the director of the department receiving a draft of the agreement. Under this long-term agreement, we want to bring together capacity and resources and focus to address some of the challenges that I have already highlighted. And in particular for the Kafue Flats, we have identified three key priorities for action. The first one being law enforcement, particularly with supply of equipment and logistics. We are already on the ground on this with partners. We have recently provided water transport. We are committed to improving the ground situation with transport. We want to particularly improve the coverage and the frequency of patrols in the area so that the presence of law enforcement officers can also act as a deterrent to would-be poachers. We are also committed to recruiting and training village scouts from the surrounding areas so that we can increase the number of personnel on the ground from the current reported 30 to the recommended 80, so that we have the optimal number of presence on the ground to manage the Kafue Flats. The second priority that we have in the area is park management and restoration. This is the core of the program. And this will involve updating or developing general management plans. According to Zambian legislation, each park should be managed according to a general management plan that's approved, and each of the buffer zones must be managed according to a land use plan. This creates a framework for managing the different activities. As you've already noticed, the Kafue Flats is a conflicted floodplain, both actual and potential. So management plans and land use plans help to manage these conflicts and mitigate against the negative impact. We are also committed to continuing biodiversity monitoring for two important reasons: that we want to see where the species are relative to the threats that we have identified, but this is also an important activity in measuring how our efforts are performing in changing the situation on the ground. Being a floodplain, and an important one for that matter of local, national, and international value, we are working with the Worldwide Fund for Nature to address water management problems, particularly mimicking natural flooding levels for the area through design and implementation of environmental flows with the Water Resources Management Authority, a new legislation that empowers more stakeholder participation in managing water resources. We are also committed to removing invasive species. And Griffin will talk a bit more about that. But the work that has happened so far in removing invasive species has shown tremendous impact in terms of what can happen once an invasive species is removed. We have seen the return of not just large herds of lechwe, as can be seen in the picture, but a diversity of waterbeds that are using the area. Our third priority, perhaps the most important, given the character and historical nature of the Kafue Flats, is that of community engagement and livelihood. Rich has already mentioned the fact that for thousands of years, the Kafue Flats has been inhabited by people who managed the resources and kept livestock and did a bit of subsistence agriculture and fishing in a balanced way. But in recent years, this balance has been negatively tipped due to population increases and development. But we recognize the fact that this is largely an area where communities are as an integral part of the area as the other resources themselves. So based on lessons we have learned from community conservation across the country in other areas, effective participation and joint designs of solutions which brings communities at the center is a key aspect of what we are engaging in. We are particularly mindful of the fact that lessons suggest that where benefits for communities are clear in whatever interventions are being proposed, and where the roles and responsibilities of the key stakeholders, including communities, are also clear, support for conservation increases and the chance of success also increases. So with engagement of communities and design, we are aiming to have sustainable fisheries and sustainable beef production, investigate diverse income generation, but as well engage schools and communities in promoting awareness so that we also promote an approach that doesn't only focus on utilization and extraction at the moment, but enhance a sense of stewardship over the years now and into the future. Our ultimate dream for the Kafue Flats is a thriving floodplain for all, one that maintains a nature-based economy, both local and national, but also where the ecosystem services, of which there are many and diverse, as shown in the picture, are also maintained. But importantly, that livelihoods of the local community are guaranteed. But in this balanced and integrated approach, we particularly want to see that any conflicts that arise or are present are managed rather than ignored, that the potential that we see in the bird life and the lechwe and the cranes, that this potential is tapped rather than wasted. But the big opportunity that we see, which we want to utilize, is that there's strong government support, there's strong political will, there's enthusiasm among stakeholders. And we feel that with this situation, we can work together as partners to turn the situation around. We are also convinced, finally, that this is worth every effort and we want to apply ourselves to it. And we are very grateful for this opportunity to apply ourselves in partnership with government and other stakeholders to try and address the challenges of the Kafue Flats in having a thriving floodplain for all. Thank you for your attention. I'm now going to turn over the mic to my colleague, Griffin Shanongu, who not only comes from the area, but has spent his life working in the area as an ecologist, and is currently using the work that we've been doing there as the International Crane Foundation for his PhD. I'm privileged to ask Griffin to talk to you now. Thanks for your attention.
Hello, and thank you for joining, and good evening and good morning to everyone around the world. My name is Griffin Shanongu. I've been a wildlife ecologist on the Kafue Flats since 2006, and this year is 14 years of working in that area. And I've been working with the International Crane Foundation since 2013. And basically, my work has been mostly to do with understanding the relationship with the hydrology and vegetation of the wetland, and how all that is interacting with wildlife, both mammals and large waterbirds, including cranes and other species that are of conservation concern. Also, I've been doing a lot of work on aerial surveys, understanding the population dynamics of the Kafue Lechwe, and also understanding the dynamics of the cranes and other species there. Also, I'm a very keen birder. I like birding. And also, I serve as the scientific and technical review panel focal point for Zambia under the Ramsar Convention. So basically today, I just want to speak to you about the work that we've been doing on the Kafue Flats with regards to controlling invasive alien species, and in particular, the Mimosa pigra. Before I continue with my presentation, I just want to let you know that Mimosa pigra is one of the worst weeds that are impacting both tropical and subtropical wetlands of the world. And Mimosa is a problem in Southeast Asia in the Mekong Delta, and also is a problem in the Northern Territory of Australia in the Kakadu National Park, where large tracts of land have been covered by Mimosa pigra and impacting biodiversity there. On the Kafue Flats, Mimosa has been spreading from about two hectares, and now occupies over 3,000 hectares, which is about 6,000 acres area covered. But as you can see on this picture, Mimosa covers large areas of grassland. So the green, the dark green vegetation there, lush, looking lush and healthy, is the Mimosa pigra, and it's quite prickly. And it's very thorny, so no other animals can live in that particular area, and also excludes waterbirds. Also, as you can see, there's a stream right in the middle of this infestation. And so for mimosa growing in this particular area also prevents access to water by wildlife and also domestic animals that are found within the particular area. So much of the habitat for the cranes and the lechwes and all the other species that are found in the Kafue Flats have been lost due to the Mimosa pigra infestation. And as you can tell from now that it's really important to clear Mimosa pigra, and efforts have been undertaken previously to try and control the infestation. So the picture on the top left corner of this presentation, you can see in 2006, large areas of Mimosa were covering, and then some control efforts were undertaken between 2007 and 2010. And after that, no efforts were undertaken, as there was no major follow-up to maintain project gains. And you can see in 2017, much of those areas that were previously covered have been completely overtaken by the Mimosa pigra again. And so what we have been undertaking since 2017 is to try and do this work again to try and restore large tracts of land. At the moment, we have instituted a community-based removal program, and this is supported with the Department of National Parks and Wildlife, as well as the WWF Zambia program here. So since 2017, we started this community-based control program, where we aim at removing at least 95% of the current infestation. And one of our key issues is to try and restore the habitat for the cranes and for other wildlife that are dependent on these species. So to explain a little bit more about the work that we do is that first and foremost, what we're trying to undertake in this particular project is to undertake physical removal using handheld tools, and then also apply safe use of herbicides to completely remove Mimosa pigra, and then undertake various biological control experimentation as a way of sustaining our project gains beyond the project. And so the first step that we undertake on the physical removal is that we employed at least 150 people from the surrounding local communities who come into the national park. And one of their major tasks is to try and cut the Mimosa pigra to ground level using handheld tools. And then the next action is to try and stack all the Mimosa pigra and stack it up and pull it together and leave it for a couple of weeks. And then once it's dry enough, we burn. And the reason why we burn is that it's important to burn this this large foliage of mimosa, because that burning action breaks the dormancy of the seeds. And by breaking the dormancy of the seed, much of the seeds germinate. And we've seen that the germination of the seed is up to about 1,000 seedlings that are germinating within 1 week of burning. And so breaking the dormancy of the seed is quite important, because if the dormancy of the seeds are not broken, the seeds can remain viable in the system for up to 20 years. And so once we burn, the next action is to move in and try to spray the mimosa picker using a safe herbicide. And the reason why we do that is that if we do not undertake this particular work, much of those areas will be completely reinvaded by the mimosa picker. So the spraying of this herbicide works in maintaining the project gains, and we're targeting specifically the mimosa picker that is regenerating and avoiding the native grass species. And of course, I should emphasize that that is a safe use of herbicide, and where we ensure that all the people that are trained to undertake this work are safely and secure from to prevent any spillage or injury to themselves. And of course, after this action is undertaken, one of the things that we really want to do is to try and undertake some biological control experimentation. At the moment, what we've done is that we've released a moth that suppresses mimosa picker growth by burrowing through its stems. By burrowing through the stem, it reduces the growth vigor of the mimosa, and by so doing, allows the native vegetation to come through. Moth is referred to, or is called Camenta mimosa, and has been tested in Australia and Southeast Asia, where it has proven to be quite successful. So we have released this this biological control agent in Lokimva National Park last year, and has been slowly establishing, and we're hoping to mass rear this a moth so that we can release it to other areas where we are not undertaking any physical and chemical control, as a way of sustaining our projects beyond the 2020 project life cycle. One of the things that we've observed after we've done all this clearing, especially removing mimosa pigra and having the native vegetation grow, is that once that happens, there's a large herds of herbivores that come into those areas that have been cleared, especially the lechwe and the hippos. And so one of the things that we do observe is that the lechwes are strict grazers. They will not eat anything else except for grass, and their trampling and their dung deposition definitely could play a role in influencing the regeneration of mimosa. Because when they're grazing on the grass, they're avoiding mimosa pigra. And so we think that by the grazing action of the lechwes is giving the mimosa a competitive advantage over the native species. And for us to understand the relationship between restoration vegetation, restoration of the floodplain and grazing, what we've done is that we've constructed a number of grazing enclosures, some sort of an experiment that we're undertaking in the floods. After we've removed the mimosa, we construct these grazing enclosures to exclude grazing. And by excluding grazing, we're allowing the vegetation to grow without any influence of trampling, dung deposition, and grazing of the lechwes. And then after that, after a couple of years, we've been undertaking some vegetation recording and also measuring mimosa height to try and see the impact of the grazing of the lechwe on the restoration of mimosa pigra itself. And so what we find in this experimentation is that as it is obvious, you can see that in the areas where these cages have been constructed, there's no grazing and there's lush floodplain grassland growing in there. And then all around the cages is nothing growing because it's been all completely been grazed out. And so the grazing of the lechwe and the hippos definitely do play a role in the restoration of the vegetation following the grazing. And what we see also is that in the areas where we have excluded grazing, there is less seedlings of mimosa than the areas where grazing is permitted. But it's surprisingly, we find that in the areas where grazing is not permitted, the mimosa pygra grows quite higher and much more taller than in the areas where grazing and trampling is permitted. And so we think that, large herbivores do play a key role in maintaining or suppressing the growth of the mimosa. And maybe one of the things that we try to understand is to see how if we can include large grazing herbivores in the system to be able to keep the mimosa from growing quite rapidly. So interesting results and are very comparable to some of the studies that have been undertaken in Mozambique. So what has been our project to date? So far we've cleared approximately 2000 hectares, about 4000 acres of area, and over 1000 hectares have been followed up with the safe use of herbicides. And by the end of this year, we're targeted to clear at least 800 hectares or 1600 acres. And on the map that you can see, for example, the blue is water, obviously, but then the dark green is the flatland grassland that we're trying to restore. And the red is the mimosa pygra itself. So on the left corner of your screen, you can see the red mimosas are quite dense. And as of last year in 2019, you see the area covered by the red mimosa in this system has been reduced, and the area of flatland grassland has actually increased. So we feel that this is a great success and something that we should definitely continue doing beyond 2020. So very interesting results that we see, and much areas have been cleared. But then also, what are the ecological impacts that have happened? In these areas that we've cleared, we've seen the return of wattled crane and great crown crane, and we've been observing a number of breeding pairs of great crown cranes and wattled cranes in these areas. Excuse me. And also large flocks of wattled cranes coming back into these areas and utilizing the nice vegetation that is there. And one of the things that we've observed is that, a number of species have been observed, new species for Zambia have been observed in the areas that have been cleared of the mimosa. And native vegetation is coming back and is popping up and accessed by wildlife and to watering areas has been opened up, which is very, very beneficial for the ecological ecosystem health of this area. Also from the human well-being point of view, we've employed since 2017, at least 450 people from the surrounding local communities. Like Rich mentioned earlier, these are job opportunities that would not have been there had we not instituted this project here. And so this has been quite a good thing where we've employed people to come in and be employed, and 450 people means definitely 450 households in the surrounding local communities. And so from a socioeconomic point of view, it has been quite a good success. And also we've seen that in the areas where we're permitting access for wildlife and fishing, the fishing communities and the people that are keeping livestock have had good access to watering points and others. Also the tourism potential of the park is slowly being building up. And as you know, with ecotourism, as more and more people come in, there's a lot more opportunities for job creation through ecotourism activities. Furthermore, one of the key lessons that we learned in concluding my discussion today is that it is important to include local communities in large-scale invasive species removal. Community buy-in is very, very important in any conservation activities that we do around the world. And so we are proud of having to work with a strong number of people from the local communities. And also by involving the local communities, you enhance their livelihoods and at the same time, promoting conservation of these areas. And one of the key things that we definitely are interested in is to undertake follow-up action. So if we do not do anything beyond 2020, much of these areas that have been cleared will be reinvaded by the mimosa, and all our efforts would have resulted to nothing if we did not do anything beyond 2020. So this is what we've been looking at. And so thank you so much for your attention, and I'm handing you back to Rich. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Griffin and Mwape. And just to wrap up here, and then we'll go to some questions soon, I hope you'll join us in feeling excitement about this area. Our goal is really to help put the Kafue Flats back on the map and make it one of the next great conservation success stories in Africa. But a little bit of a different story. It's a story about people and wildlife together and finding that balance. And that's really the key to what we need to achieve. As you saw earlier in this slide from WAPE, we're not trying to create a national park system in the traditional sense of the word, but one that can both feed and support the population that lives there and has lived there for the millennium, and feed and support the wildlife that needs this system so desperately. So that's our goal, our sort of win-win, maybe elusive at times these days, but our goal to see this through. And we hope you can join in our vision to make the Kafue Flats a thriving floodplain for all. I wanna thank many of the supporters who have contributed to this work over the years. These are just some who have contributed in recent years to the success of the Kafue Flats. We are so grateful to all of them. Also to our sponsors, who's also a supporter of this work, Jean and Ed Eldoranto, in honor of their family, again, in Lusaka, Zambia, which is really fun. So thank you so much for joining us today. And with that, I'd like to take some of your questions and feed them back to Mwape and Griffin carry the conversation a little bit further here. I've got several questions that have come in here, and they were queued up to me by Karen Morrison, our Africa Program Director. Thanks again, Karen. There, first up, first the question is, considering the imminent rise, increase in climate change, is there a projection of how many centuries or decades there will be able to continue to enjoy the Kafue Flats in their current sort of pristine nature? That's the first question that came up. Mwape, do you want to take that one?
Rich, thanks. That's a deep question. Of course, part of the National Climate Change Assessment for Zambia identifies the Kafue Flats as an area that's going to suffer reduced rainfall as well as increased heat. It is difficult to give a clear position on how long we still have the Kafue Flats. I think that the bigger question is what we can begin to do in terms of enhancing the ecosystem resilience of the area so that it's much better able to handle the adverse impacts and extreme events that climate change is bringing our way. Just last year, we had a drought in the area, and this is expected, as you know, to increase in frequency and severity. But just in terms of how long it will take before this area becomes completely dry, that I'm not able to answer that question. Rich, perhaps you can chip in on that one.
Just to add, I think an important part of the flats is that the waters that feed the flats come from the far north of Zambia, which is a higher rainfall area. And one of the things that excites us about this system is exactly what we saw last year on the flats, which is that it was a pretty good rainfall year to the north and up in Angola and to the north of Zambia, and very dry in southern Zambia. And so there was a lot of water on the flats, and it was one of the only wet areas in a region that was otherwise very dry. And it really brought to a fore how critically important the flats can be during drought periods when there's broader rainfall in the basin. And in fact, rainfall in Angola is not predicted to change very much in the coming years, whereas as you move further and further south in southern Africa, it is expected to become drier. So these river systems are truly lifelines, and their floodplains become real centers for conservation and for human use. And that's part of why we're energized. I think our goal is to keep water on the flats forever, and to do that by taking both advantage of the regional climate differences and to create a sustainable path there. So that's a great question. One for you, Griffin. What is the relationship between Kafue Lechwe and the cranes on the flats?
I think that, thank you for that question, very interesting. The relationship is a mutual beneficial one. One of the things that I've been doing or researching on is, the relationship between the Lechwe and the cranes in Kafue Flats, as well as the Bangweulu and the Liwa. And we see that once the population of one species goes down, the population of the other also pretty much goes down. So the relationship is that the large herds or large numbers of lechwes on the flats are important in grazing and removing some of the high grass, and allows the wattled crane to be able to access their food, especially through burrowing the tubers and the other food sources that they depend on. So it's a mutual beneficial type of relationship that we do see. So conserving or protecting the populations of the lechwe would definitely be beneficial for the long term population viability of the wattled crane.
Great. Another good question that came in. We'll send this one over to Mwape. What stage are the negotiations between Zambian Parks and Wildlife and the management of the Kafue Flats? If those negotiations for our management agreement are not finalized, what are the impediments?
Thank you. That's a question that's at the heart of our commitment at the moment. I am happy to inform you that the negotiations are quite advanced. We have a stakeholder approved draft of the agreement that's been submitted to government for final review and approval. And we have at the moment, as we speak, a commitment from the director of the Department of National Parks that for purposes of work on the ground, we are already in the agreement, we are already in a relationship, and we have this letter confirming that for purposes of the work, we can go ahead. Are we expecting challenges in the agreement? We think that because it has to be approved by the entire government, it might take long. But we feel that because government has recognized the situation on the Kafue Flats as a crisis, we feel that the work that needs to go on has to start going on and has started going on. And we feel that we have a short window in which we can turn around the situation on the Kafue Flats. So we are of the strong belief that although the signed agreement isn't in our hands yet, we have a very advanced draft and a letter of commitment with which we are already for the past 2 years putting together plans and resources and capacities that are required to address the crisis that has been documented over the years and is getting deeper. So that's a very good question, and thank you for asking us. It is something that we are following up, and we are looking forward to a good outcome, and we feel that at the moment we are in a good place already. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mwape. A question back for Griffin. Mwape mentioned at the beginning, Griffin, that Griffin's ancestors actually come from the Kafue Flats area. And one of the questions here is, how do we intend on dealing with the number of cattle, sort of regulating the number of livestock? What are your ideas about how to refine that balance between cattle and lechwe on the floodplain?
Yeah, that's it's not a very easy question to answer. It's not a very easy problem to solve. But I think that with engaging the local communities, my ancestors there, because our way of life is to be pastoralists, so we pride ourselves on having, thousands and thousands of cattle. And so to change the paradigm, it would be difficult, but I think that the conversation can be started and try and see how, you can have both satisfy the wishes of the local communities and also advance the agenda of increasing the habitat for the lechwe. Not very easy, but something that definitely can be solved and can be achieved, especially with a lot of communications between the local communities, their leadership, local people, and doing a lot of beef production type of education system and see how, a solution can be found.
Thank you. If you allow me, Rich, to add to that great question. It's not our intention under this program to remove livestock from the Kafue Flats. Our dream is to create a model that uses incentives to manage the cattle population. And the mechanics of it is that we are theorizing that if we are honest and open in our consultations and in accepting that the livestock are part of the system, but we also through engagement share the vision with the communities and the livestock keepers, that the number of livestock is not sustainable for the system, then we are in a position where we can begin to negotiate on two fronts. One, which is that we try and secure good markets for sustainably produced beef that's grazed on the natural rich grass of the Kafue Flats. And we hope that that secure, assured market can be strong enough an incentive to enter into further negotiations with the communities, that we also engage in improving herd quality so that we end up with high quality livestock, but fewer numbers that are fetching them the same price, if not higher than what they are fetching at the moment. So we are hoping that part of the model will be an incentive-based mechanism that helps to shift from the current unsustainable numbers and grazing to a more sustainable and mutually beneficial grazing system involving livestock that benefits the communities, but also greatly enhances the ecosystem. Thanks, Rich.
Thanks, and a closely related question is about what's the community response to the project, Ben, and maybe Griffin and Mwape, you can share some of the feedback from the community about the Mimosa project in particular.
I think the response has been tremendous. We've received overwhelming interest from a lot of young people in the area who want to come in and be part of the control work. And we've also been talking to the local leadership there who have been encouraging us and supporting the work. And also, even including, letting people from their local communities to come in and stay for a couple of weeks in the park to be able to do this work that we are undertaking. So the response has been tremendous, and there's a lot of support of this work. And a lot of these people definitely do want this project to continue going on, because one of the things is that it provides an employment opportunities for the young people. And so they definitely would want this work to go on. And having them doing the work together with us is also benefiting us in the sense that we're restoring valuable habitat for the crane. So it's definitely a win-win situation, if you may, where local people are having some gainful employment opportunities, and as well as restoring of degraded habitats on the Kafue Flats.
We have also been highly inspired by the response from the traditional authorities and community leaders, which is that contrary to what we expected, given the actual and potential conflicts on the ground, what we have come across is that there is a shared appreciation of the degradation of the Kafue Flats and how this threatened the ecosystems and ultimately their livelihoods. We were inspired by this because then it puts us on the same footing in terms of beginning to look at solutions. So we think that we are enjoying adequate support from the communities, but of course lessons from community conservation right across the globe suggests, as I mentioned earlier on, that you've got to have the roles lined up clearly and benefits clearly discussed and demonstrated and go beyond just consultation. So as things stand now, we have acquired the level of support that we need from stakeholders, including communities, but needless to say, there's a lot of work to be done, and we are committed to a model of community engagement that is effective, that is serious, and respects the realities of the communities on the ground. Because as I said, without them, we will achieve very little. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Mwape. And the last question that came in is kind of, I'm going to kind of combine the last two questions so we can wrap up here. Someone who obviously knows Zambia very well asked a question. The Kafue Flats does not have the level of tourism that you find on the Lua Plains or Kafue National Park, or could add other areas like Luangwa in the eastern part of Zambia. So what's the objective of a 20-year agreement, considering that the Kafue Flats may not yield tourism returns in the foreseeable future? And I'll sort of take this one as part of the wrap up, which is to say, an important thing about this project is we never saw it fundamentally as a tourism project. This is a conservation and restoration project, and we're trying to create a long-term sustainability model for this project that's not so much based on tourism income as it is on income related to managing the park and making the park successful, and the philanthropy project to really restore and make this a fantastic park. And the reason that we're encouraged by that right now, to be honest, is that, as you know, tourism across Africa has taken a phenomenal hit. And some of the big parks, like the ones I just mentioned that are completely dependent on tourism, are hit extremely hard now by the basically 100% lack of tourists in Africa right now and for the foreseeable future with the COVID-19 shutdowns that we're seeing on international travel and all. And so our model and our work for the next 5 to 10 years is really about rebuilding this as an ecosystem and as rehabilitating it to be this model that we want for people and wildlife. And then the tourism comes down the road. So we're really focused on sustainably funding and supporting this project through that time period. And then down the road, as tourism returns to Africa, and as we can make the Kafue Flats again a great tourism product, we can bring that back into the fore. So I think right now it's a bit of an advantage in thinking to not be quite so dependent on that revenue, which is taking a very serious hit. And the final question was really just from people saying, how can we help? We really appreciate that. That's it. All of our projects like this are donor supported. We are so grateful to people who want to support this work. And of course, the work of the International Crane Foundation. You can find us on www.savingcranes.org if you want to find more information about how to donate, if you want to give specifically to the Kafue Flats effort. We, of course, welcome that, and you can specify that when you go to that link. But we do see it, you know, for the foreseeable future as a combination of grants and philanthropy to get the Kafue Flats back on its feet. We consider it both a conservation and a humanitarian project to really get this area thriving again, and that's very important to us. So thank you for asking that question and for all of your questions. We really appreciate it. I would just want to wrap up here and say thank you all again for joining us. Our next From the Field is next week on Cranes and Artists, a creative dance. That will be wonderful. You'll see we've got three different presenters joining us for that and a sponsor. And we're so grateful that you join us each of these weeks, learn more about our work, ask how you can help in so many ways. We're grateful to have this great community of members out there and people interested in our work and interested in the conservation of wild cranes and the ecosystems they depend on. Thanks again for joining us today. And we hope to see you next week at our next webinar. Yeah, have a good day.